for that. And it's now time for a question period. The Leader of Her Majesty's Loyal Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Acting Premier. It has been 8 years since the government created the LHINs, and for those 8 years, the Auditor General has noted the province has failed to determine or establish a way to judge their performance. Not surprisingly, she said that it makes it pretty difficult to determine whether they have any value for money. However, we know the minister has promised change. Mr. Speaker, is the government scrapping the LHINs, or after 8 years of creating them, have they finally figured out what they're doing?
To the Minister of Health.
Mr. Speaker, and it gives me the opportunity to thank the Auditor General for her most recent report, her annual report, that does reference and speak to both our CCACs and LHINs, Mr. Speaker. These recommendations build and point us in a direction that already builds on the strong accountability and performance measurements that we have in place in our health care system, including through our LHINs. They have a responsibility, as this legislature knows, to integrate health care across the health care system. We do know, and the Auditor General has spoken to this, Mr. Speaker, we do know that there is additional work to be done to further strengthen the accountability measures, make sure that we're measuring the appropriate outcomes as well, so we can continue to improve the quality of care through that important role that our LHINs do play.
Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, again to the Acting Premier, and I appreciate the fact it seems to be every Liberal minister's speaking notes to say, I thank the Auditor General. The AG report, if you've read it, the 773 pages, is an indictment on your government. But I will continue. Whether you live in Moosonee, Milton, or Muskoka, the people of Ontario deserve the highest quality of health care across our province. Sadly, the performance levels across Ontario and the 14 LHINs have been substandard. The AG reported none of the 14 LHINs have ever met all of their targets in 15 areas of performance. But that wasn't news to the minister. LHIN performance targets are a problem year after year. The minister's response to these problems, according to the AG, was take little action to hold the LHINs accountable when low performance continues. So if you really want to thank the AG, maybe for once in your time as minister, you can actually listen to the Auditor General.
Thank you. Be seated, please. Thank you. Minister.
Got it. I'll do both. Right. Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And I know that the PCs, had they been in power today, would have gotten rid of the LHINs, fired the workers. We believe on this side of government that it's important that health care decisions be taken at the local level. They be taken in the community, not at Queen's Park, Mr. Speaker. That they be taken at a level where we have community representation on local boards making local decisions that apply to local.
It's difficult to get control when the side that's answering is heckling too. And I'm right to say that the member from Leeds-Grenville, I don't need an armchair quarterback. Let's just listen to the answer and listen to the question. Please finish. You have a wrap-up.
Mr. Speaker, I'm pleased to quote the AG. She says, I'm pleased to report that over three-quarters of these actions have been either fully implemented or in the process of being implemented. I want to especially note the exemplary performance of the Ministry of Education, OPG, Service Ontario, and the Ministry of Health and Long-Term Care in implementing recommendations from our audit 2 years ago.
Final supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, again to the Acting Premier, and based on their responses, I really wonder if they've even seen the AG report, because they have a different interpretation of the AG report compared to everyone in Ontario who has looked at it and every single media report. You know,
Deputy House Leader.
To the Acting Premier, Ontario has community care access centres, and thanks to the AG, we know that they spend 40 cents of every dollar on administrative costs and CEO salaries. We have two levels of health care bureaucracy that the average patient doesn't interact with. They interact with personal support workers, nurses, and doctors. That's where funding should go. Not an $800 million cut to patient care, not physiotherapy cuts in long-term care homes. claims. The AG report makes it very clear that this minister has ignored her previous recommendations. Mr. Speaker,
question.
Will this government continue to ignore the Auditor General? Will it be more spin, or will they finally do the right thing and listen to the Auditor General?
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. Minister.
Well, Mr. Speaker, this was the second report this year by the Auditor General that referenced and dealt specifically with our CCACs, as I did in September with her first report, where I embraced her recommendations and indicated the commitment of this government to implement every single one of them. We're working on these latest recommendations as well. And Mr. Speaker, in the very near future, I will be releasing, this government will be releasing a discussion paper which speaks specifically to her recommendations and to further changes on top of the 10 changes that I announced and were implementing earlier this year, responding to the Gail Donner report on home and community care. We implemented an action plan focusing on function. The discussion paper will speak.
The member from Leeds, Grenville, come to order.
Required to improve the quality of care through home and community care.
Before I move to a new question, the member from Leeds, Grenville, as soon as I said come to order, you kept going. You're supposed to stop when I talk to you. And the member from Dufferin-Callanan could also come to order. New question. The Leader of the Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, to the Acting Premier, since I can't get an answer on the lack of action on the LHINs, let's talk about long-term care. Ontario's long-term care homes provide for the province's most frail and vulnerable people. They must be held to the highest standard when it comes to residents' dignity, health and safety. But what we have learned from the Auditor General, we've learned that the backlog of complaints and critical incidents has more than doubled since 2013 during the time of our current Premier. When will they give residents the long-term care homes and their families the peace of mind and security they deserve? This is your mess. This entire fiasco is on your watch. Will you own it? Will you respond to the AG and do something meaningful in regards to long-term care?
Thank you. Deputy Premier.
To the Associate Minister of Health.
Associate Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
Thank you, Speaker. I thank the Leader of the Opposition for that question. As I said yesterday, we accept the findings and recommendations of the Auditor General, and we actually thank the Auditor General for her work. And I'm pleased to report, Mr. Speaker, that we are already implementing her recommendations. First, all outstanding inspections determined as high risk by the Auditor General have now been completed. Especially important, Mr. Speaker, we are well on our way to implementing her recommendations. Some of these initiatives, Mr. Speaker, have been underway for some time, long before the Auditor General's report came out. For example, we are working with our partners to ensure stronger measures on repeated non-compliance, expanding the number of offense provisions under the current legislation. All this to say, Mr. Speaker, we accept.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, again to the Acting Premier or the Minister responsible for long-term care, you may say you're accepting the Auditor General's recommendations, but you know who doesn't believe that? The Auditor General, because she says in her report you're not taking the advice, you're not realizing the situation that exists in Ontario. This backlog isn't an issue the government can shrug off. Last year, the majority of critical incidents requiring inspections were a result of neglect or abuse. In just 1 year, that number has increased 90%. On your watch. There were 1,750 of those incidents reported in 2014. Our senior citizens, our frail, our vulnerable deserve better. Mr. Speaker, why isn't this government making a priority of this mess? Why is this government not investigating these serious complaints?
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Since we're in the business of quoting the auditor's report, let me quote something here as well, Mr. Speaker. While we acknowledge we must do, Mr. Speaker, I am pleased that the Auditor General has acknowledged, and I quote, the ministry's new comprehensive inspection process was an improvement over its previous inspection program, and that the inspection process is more extensive than those in other provinces. And, Mr. Speaker, it's a little rich coming questions on inspections from the opposition, who never even inspected long-term care homes when they were in power. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Final supplementary.
12 years.
Final supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, again to the acting premier, according to the AG report, four of the five regional offices had complaints or critical incidents that have been outstanding for more than a year. More than a year. Astonishingly, 65% of cases were closed without inspection and had insufficient information to show why an inspection was not required, and you're proud of that. This government has ignored the complaints of families. They simply told them to go away with no explanation as to why their complaint wasn't investigated. Wow. This is just callous. Mr. Speaker, you know, I've got a loved one in a long-term care facility, and I would be absolutely livid if there was a serious incident and we complained and there was no investigation. Thank goodness that hasn't happened in my family, but it's happened to 65% of the complaints
Question.
That I had in Ontario. How can you stand by this? How can you spin your way out of this? This is wrong. Deal with it.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. Associate Minister.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and once again I thank the Leader of the Opposition for his question. And as I said before, let me repeat this, all outstanding inspections—
Excuse me. Let's keep the battle of the books away. Carry on.
So, Mr. Speaker, as I was saying, all outstanding inspections determined as high risk by the Auditor General have now been completed. And the reason, Mr. Speaker, is that we do take our inspection process very seriously. We do take the recommendations of the Auditor General very seriously, and we are working to implement those recommendations, and work has already started. But again, Mr. Speaker, very rich coming from the opposition, a party that, when they were in power for long periods of time, completely forgot to do any inspections.
Answer.
Shame on you.
New question. Member from Nickelville.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Ma question pour la Première ministre.
Thank you. My question is for the acting premier.
Seniors are waiting as long as 198 days before they get home care. My question is very simple. What happened to the Liberal commitment to five-day home care?
Thank you.
To the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And as I mentioned before, Mr. Speaker, we've had now three important, I would call seminal, reports this year alone. Gail Donner at the beginning of the year, two reports now from the Auditor General. I take all of those reports equally as seriously. The important aspect of these reports is that they provide very specific guidance and recommendations, Mr. Speaker. I've embraced and supported and accepted all three of the reports, committed to implementing their recommendations. We are well on our way, Mr. Speaker, to implementing many of the recommendations expressed in these reports. Earlier this year, I released an action plan focusing on improving the quality of care and addressing, including addressing the issues referenced by the member opposite. In the coming weeks, I will be issuing a further discussion paper, which will be making significant proposals for change to continue to improve. Yep.
Thank you. Member from Nickelbelt.
Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, our Premier promised she was not going to cut health care. But so far, the track record is quite different. She's fired over 625 nurses this year alone. 150 health care workers in North Bay are receiving pink slip for Christmas. 84 jobs are being cut in Belvington and Trelton Hospital. On Friday, we learned that another 12 jobs are being lost at St. Joseph Hospital in Hamilton, and the list goes on. Hospitals from Oshawa to Sarnia to Ottawa to Sault Ste. Marie are cutting frontline healthcare workers because of this government funding freeze. But you know what, Speaker? Every one of these cuts hurts patients' care. What happened to the Liberals' promise not to cut health care?
Question. Thank you. Minister.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. It's important to note that the NDP party voted against our budget that had an increase of $250 million of new money to invest in home and community care. And it was the NDP government that, under their watch, there were, as a result of their decisions, 3,000 fewer RNs were employed in this province as a result of measures taken by that party when they were in government. We've taken the opposite approach, Mr. Speaker. We're investing in home care more than 800,000.
If it starts up, I'll go to the individual. Carry on.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Since 2003, there are now 24,000 more nurses employed in this province than were when we came into office, Mr. Speaker. These are important investments. Our commitment to our nursing professionals is there. Our commitment to improving home and community care is as vital as it always has been.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. Well, over the last few weeks, we've heard a lot about transformation in the healthcare sector. The Minister of Health uses that word all the time. So does Ed Clark, the Premier Privatization Advisor and Chief Hydro Auctioneer. But what we are really seeing, Speaker, are seniors waiting over 200 days for home care. When the Liberal had a commitment to 5 days, we see nurses being fired when we had a commitment not to cut health care, and we see people that need care that can't get access. When I heard transformation, Speaker, I hear a weasel word. Our deeper cuts and even longer wait lists.
That's not parliamentary. Withdraw, please.
I withdraw, Speaker. When I hear transformation, I'm wondering, are deeper cuts and even longer wait lists the sort of transformation the Liberals are planning for us?
Well, Mr. Speaker, we're doing the opposite of what the member opposite is alleging. We're increasing our investments in home and community care. We're increasing the number of visits that are available to Ontarians. We're now, last year alone, our nurses and personal support workers saw 35 million visits across this province. That was 1.3 million more visits than took place the year previous. We're increasing our investments in home and community care this year by roughly $250 million, so that we're spending almost $5 billion. A tenth of the health care budget, Mr. Speaker, is being invested in home and community care, where it should be, Mr. Speaker, as it helps us move people out of hospitals into their homes, into their communities, where they can be better cared for due to innovations and the supports of it. And that's where they want to be, Mr. Speaker.
Sure.
Thank you. New question. The member from Essex.
Thank you very much, Speaker. My question is to the Acting Premier. Speaker, the Auditor General said that she was concerned about how the Liberal government was handing out job creation dollars without any accountability or without even checking whether the money was needed in the first place. The question is quite simple, Speaker. When will the government be appointing the arm's-length boards and independent advisory committees for the Southwestern Ontario Development Fund and the Eastern Ontario Development Fund?
Thank you.
Minister of Economic Development, Employment and Infrastructure.
Minister.
Mr. Speaker, I want to thank the member for that question. It's a question I look forward to addressing. But, Mr. Speaker, I think that's important as well to recognize when a member asks a question that's a legitimate question and when sometimes members get up in righteous indignation when they have no right to do so. And, Mr. Speaker, I want to compare your question to the question the Leader of the Opposition yesterday. When he got up in righteous indignation, here's a member, Mr. Speaker, who served in a federal government that supported 3,000 jobs in partnering with Oakville through those very same business supports, 8,000 jobs in Guelph through those very same business supports, 8,000 jobs in Cambridge and Woodstock. Where was the righteous indignation then? But, Mr. Speaker, this takes the cake. I recall being in Barrie, Mr. Speaker, at the launch of a data centre through a partnership with the federal government, and I have a photo with myself, Mayor Layman, and the Leader of the Opposition, and his smiling face, Mr. Speaker, cutting a ribbon with us, to support programs.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Start the clock. Order. Supplementary.
Speaker, I appreciate that the minister considers my question as legitimate. I would appreciate a legitimate answer to the question. Yeah. Speaker, in 2012, MPPs passed legislation to ensure that the Eastern Development Fund and the Southwestern Ontario Development Fund would have independent boards, they would have local advisory committees, and annual reporting to create much-needed transparency in this House, but the government is refusing to put into action those sections into law. This is just another example of the government failing on the fundamentals of governance. After last week's Auditor General's report, it's clear that the government isn't up to the job to managing job creation in this province and making sure that those funds work for Ontarians. I'll ask again, Speaker, when will those independent boards be appointed in this House?
Minister.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I appreciate the patience of the member opposite and giving me the opportunity to state something I was looking forward to saying today. But the member realizes, and in fact, we've worked with colleagues on his side of the House as well. It's really important that we strike the balance with our regional economic development funds, Mr. Speaker, to ensure that we're responding to those communities in a timely fashion. We've worked very closely with local municipalities, including his own area of Windsor. And, Mr. Speaker, we have a process that we put in place that is highly accountable. For every dollar invested, Mr. Speaker, there has to be jobs created. And if they're not, those dollars are clawed back or not flowed in the first place. There's a very stringent process of consideration for these projects,
yes,
Mr. Speaker. They are not politically determined in any way. There's a process that comes through. And, Mr. Speaker, I'd be happy to talk a little more
to the
member offline about this.
Thank you. The member from Renfrew will come to order. Final supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. Quite simply, in 2012, this House passed legislation to ensure that the Eastern Ontario Development Fund and the Southwestern Ontario Development Fund had independent boards who would make up the choices to ensure that job creation dollars helped families in our communities, not just government friends. Does the government think that job creation funds need less oversight, less independence, and
Deputy
less
House Leader, second time. Minister.
Speaker, those types of allegations, when I spent hours working with this member and talking to this member at Esmond, explaining the very stringent process we go to. To him, for him to make those allegations after knowing that we have a very stringent, a very accountable process, Mr. Speaker, is really not a fair allegation at all. And, Mr. Speaker, the fact of the matter is I do not intervene and have not intervened in any recommendation that's come forward through the Eastern Ontario Development Fund or the Southwestern Development Fund. They work their ways up through the communities, Mr. Speaker. They're open funds, and we encourage corporations, companies to take access to
them,
and communities. Mr. Speaker, communities in Southwestern Ontario and Eastern Ontario are very pleased with the administration
Thank
of these
you.
Funds. I suggest that you listen to them as well.
New question, the member from Elgin, Middlesex, London.
Speaker, my question is to the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care. Speaker, just when we thought it couldn't get any worse for home care patients in Ontario, the Auditor General tabled her report last week that revealed additional concerns about the severely troubled CCACs. What the opposition suspected, and we now know, that the ministry has done little to address multiple issues that were identified 5 years ago. 5 years later, some Ontarians are receiving less care because of where they live. 5 years later, supports still aren't available to the friends and families caring for home care clients. In fact, over 12 years, there has been no thorough evaluation of the current CCAC delivery model that ensured CCACs were providing consistent and quality care. Mr. Speaker, where was the accountability, and why, over the past 12 years, did this government set up CCACs to fail?
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. I appreciate the question again. And, Mr. Speaker, we acknowledge that there is much more work to be done. I've accepted all of the recommendations of the Auditor General in her September report. We're working on implementing those. We're working on implementing her recommendations that came out most recently in her annual report. And importantly, Mr. Speaker, this work began earlier this year in earnest when we received Gail Donner's report on home and community care that pointed the way, and we accepted each one of her recommendations, turning them into an action plan focusing on the quality of care and the timeliness of providing that care. And I think even the member opposite would agree that what we need to do is we need to continue that transition, because innovations allow us to do so. The support that we're able to provide allows us to do so. Provide as much of that care as we can in the community and in the home environment.
Answer.
That's what we're working to do, and we know that there's much more work to be done, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, back to the Minister. Speaker, the Auditor General's report revealed that the number of patients served by CCACs has only increased 20%, while spending on home care services has almost doubled. This government knows that whenever possible, the ideal place to provide care to seniors is in their own home, care that prevents expensive hospital visits, that maintains their quality of life. Speaker, this government has known for quite some time that our senior population will only continue to grow. Mr. Speaker, the CCACs investigated in this report never allocated the maximum number of home care hours it could because of budget constraints. Mr. Speaker, why have the Liberals allowed CCAC bureaucracy to eat up 40% of home care funding year after year?
Thank you again, Mr. Speaker. And the member opposite is a health care professional, and he knows that in recent years the patients that he's seen or would see now, they're coming to him with increased complexity of care. That's what we're seeing in our home care environment as well, Mr. Speaker. And so our ability, fortunately, to address those individuals' needs and their family and caregivers' needs in their home and in their community, our ability to do that has increased, but it also requires those important investments to take advantage of innovations and deliver that quality of care. That's why we continue year after year to the point where almost $5 billion, 10% of the health care budget is invested in home and community care. That's going up by $250 million this year, $250 million next year, and the year after that. And we're making those changes as pointed for us by the Auditor General, by Gail Donner's report. We're continuing to make those changes to advance the quality of care, Mr. Speaker.
Your question, Member from Oshawa.
Thank you, Speaker. And my question is to the Acting Premier. Last night was a long and terrible night in Thunder Bay. At the Thunder Bay Jail, a correctional officer was taken hostage in a violent takeover of a whole floor of the jail. He was held hostage for 4 hours, and while his safe release was successfully negotiated and he is physically secure, the dangerous crisis situation went through the night and took emergency correctional personnel to finally stop. We commend the correctional officers and crisis teams who spent the night trying to keep everyone safe and secure. We know inmates are again secure as of this morning. Speaker, our jails are plagued by fires, floods, broken cell door locks, understaffing, overcrowding, especially with individuals who haven't been sentenced, drug overdoses and assaults, riots and routine lockdowns, and now we have had a violent hostage situation. This government keeps corrections out of sight and out of mind.
Question.
Will the minister now acknowledge there is a crisis in corrections? Will the minister take responsibility for the violent situation in Thunder Bay?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Attorney General.
Mr. Speaker, I can confirm that a correction officer was taken hostage last night, and as a result of successful negotiations, the officer was released. Our thoughts, of course, are with the officer, his family, his friends and colleagues at this time. Our utmost priority throughout this situation was to bring about a peaceful resolution while ensuring the safety of our staff and the public. The incident was confined to the jail. There was no inmate escapes and no threats to the safety of the general public. The circumstances of this incident are under investigation by the police and the ministry. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. And again, my question is to the Acting Premier. Speaker, this morning, correctional staff and parole officers across this province started voting on a contract that, if voted down, will put this province one step closer to a strike or lockout in our jails. At the same time, it's being reported that managers will be receiving pay increases. Speaker, we know that while jails stay chronically overcrowded and clearly dangerous, the province has built or kept aside bed space for managers in the event of a strike or lockout. The last time there was a lockout, the government used managers from other ministries and departments to staff the jails. Speaker, in light of the hostage taking and crisis in Thunder Bay, does the acting premier really want unqualified managers from various ministries like finance, the environment, or the Treasury Board running our jails?
Thank you, Attorney General.
the Deputy Premier, please.
Speaker,
there is a ratification process underway. We will let the collective bargaining process work independently, Speaker. We do believe that we have arrived at a deal that is both fair to workers and fair to the public, Speaker. But I have to say that we very much value the work and the dedication of our public servants. They do extraordinary work. We rely on their advice. We rely on their professionalism. We rely on their expertise to help make Ontario the very fine place that it is, Speaker. So there is a ratification process underway. We will let the members decide, but I have to say I think this is a good deal for everyone.
Thank you. New question. The member from Beaches, East York.
Well, thank you, Speaker. My question is for the birthday boy, the Minister of Municipal Affairs and Housing.
Appropriate knowledge, please.
Withdraw. Yeah, birthday, man. Now, climate change is an extraordinarily important issue to my constituents in Beaches, East York, and while the Premier is representing our government in Paris at the United Nations Climate Change Conference, here at home we have ongoing plans to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. And the Minister, as part of his mandate, was directed by the Premier to lead the coordinated review of the Growth Plan and the Greenbelt Plan, along with the Niagara Escarpment Plan and the Oak Ridges Marine Plans. Working closely with the Minister of Natural Resources and Forestry, his goal is to improve the alignment of investments in transit with the planning and development decisions that will create more complete communities across the province. The review is also motivated by key commitments to protect prime agricultural lands in consultation with farmers. Mr. Speaker, yesterday was a milestone with the release of the
I stand, you sit. Minister of Municipal Affairs and Housing.
Thanks, Mr. Speaker, and thanks to the member from Beaches, East York. Speaker, several months ago, our government struck a panel led by the Honourable David Crombie to review the four pieces of legislation mentioned. The panel consisted of key agricultural, municipal, environmental, and developmental sector expertise. Yesterday was a milestone for the panel's work as they presented their report. Grounded in extensive consultation through 17 public meetings attended by over 3,500 people, and after receiving over 20,000 individual written submissions, they made 87 recommendations. The significant participation and feedback is indicative of how much people want to get engaged in building strong, healthy communities. And I look forward to having the opportunity with my ministry to review all of those recommendations.
Thank you.
Thank you, Speaker, and I very much appreciate the minister's answer and the great work that he continues to do on this file. Now, Mr. Speaker, the coordinated review has received considerable praise as a shining example of public consultation. The panel and the rest of his team were involved in this important outreach should feel very proud of the diligent work that was done to update and ensure Ontario's views were heard. Speaker, we know that better planned communities translate into many benefits, including significant savings on infrastructure costs at all levels of government, and that means that more money can be spent on transit, health care, and education. It also means less driving and greenhouse gases to help fight climate change. So, Speaker, through you, will the minister tell this House how this report from Mr. Crombie, the Honourable Mr. Crombie, will be used?
Thank you. Minister.
Again, thank you to the questioner. The credit belongs entirely to the panel, Mr. Speaker, a very esteemed group of people who worked hard together to advise us on how best to combat climate change, protect agricultural lands, water, and natural resources, to keep people and goods moving, and to build healthy communities that will attract workers and jobs. Our government remains committed to working with municipalities to grow the Green Belt, and this report will also help us navigate in this important policy area. The report also will aid our government in ensuring that the Greater Golden Horseshoe, Canada's fastest growing urban region, and the province's economic engine will be able to accommodate the additional 4.5 million
Answer.
People expected.
The member from Timmins, James
Speaker,
Bay,
again,
please come
I
to
thank
order.
The panel, very esteemed group, for their great work. I look forward to working with
thank
Mr.
You.
Crombie and others to move forward.
New question, the member from Bruce Gray, Owen South.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Associate Minister of Health and Long-Term Care. The Associate Minister stated in this House last week that she was building nursing home beds. She claimed she put new beds in Thunder Bay, Kitchener-Waterloo, and Windsor. Mr. Speaker, nothing could be further from the truth. The facts are she didn't put 500 beds in Thunder Bay. The news release talks about home care, but not nursing home beds. As for Waterloo-Wellington, they've actually seen a decrease in the rate of long-term care beds per senior citizen. As for Windsor, the minister is rehashing a 2011 announcement. The truth is 2,000 seniors remain without access to a bed. The Associate Minister needs to own up to her mistake and withdraw the erroneous statements. Through you, Mr. Speaker, I ask, will she correct her statement, show accountability, and immediately release the schedule of all nursing home bed developments in Ontario?
Sounds like a good idea if there was one.
Associate Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I thank the member opposite for his question. And I'm going to reiterate the fact that we continue to invest in long-term care beds here in Ontario, Mr. Speaker, and that is why we've added 10,000 beds and counting since we came to office. We've redeveloped 13,000 beds. And I'm going to give you some
And when I said I'll wait for the person that tries to get one in, carry on.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'd like to take a recent example, Mr. Speaker. This is Village at University Gates in Waterloo. I was there at the opening on October 30th. I was there at the opening on October 30th, but it's been in operation for some time, and that's 192 new beds. That's an example, Mr. Speaker, of the beds we are investing. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
The member from Prince Edward Hastings come to order, and the member from Hamilton East Stoney Creek come to order. Supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Back to the Associate Minister. I read it.
Oh, so, excuse me. I seem to have been challenged as soon as I asked him to be quiet. He did it again. Second time for the member from Hamilton East Stoney Creek. Supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I reiterate where. With all due respect, this is pure humbug. You are not going to build any new long-term nursing care home beds. Is the Associate Minister even aware that this government has not issued a single announcement on nursing home beds in 4 years?
Wow.
This is why her second statement from last week is the one that really takes the cake, and I quote, "But we are not resting on our laurels. We have also added beds in Oshawa." End of quote. Now, that's just callous. The Oshawa Whitby facility was built to replace the one burned down in a fire in 2014 and houses the same residents displaced by that fire.
Wow.
Mr. Speaker, this government has been failing our sick and frail seniors for 12 years. Through you to the Associate Minister, I ask, why make the erroneous statements? Why won't you just admit you have no intention to build any new nursing home beds?
Good questions.
Minister.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Let me just address the issue of humbug. I would like the member opposite to ask his own colleagues who were there at the opening of the Waterloo long-term care whether they thought it was humbug.
Exactly.
Colleagues such as Michael Harris representing Kitchener-Conestoga, Ted Ornett representing Halton Hills. They were there, Mr. Speaker, representing their constituents, and you should ask them if they think it's humbug. Thank you.
Exactly. Here, here.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. The member from Prince Edward Hastings, second time. You'll get your first. New question. Member from Niagara Falls.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question today is to the Minister of Transportation. Minister, yesterday we learned that less than 8% of the trucks on our roads receive safety inspections each year. And of the trucks that do receive inspections, roughly 25% of them fail. In 2008, the Auditor General revealed serious flaws in our commercial vehicle inspection system. 7 years later, it looks like little has changed. Why does the government knowingly risk the safety of Ontarians by allowing so many unsafe trucks onto our roads?
Thank you. Minister of Transportation.
Thanks very much, Speaker. I thank the member from Niagara Falls for his question. I think that One thing he would know, because I've said it many times here in the chamber and beyond the chamber, Speaker, that over the last 13 years, the province of Ontario has ranked first or second across all of North America for road and highway safety, Speaker. That's first or second across all categories. But in particular, Speaker, over the last number of years, the amount of large truck traffic on Ontario's highways has risen dramatically. And in that same time period, Speaker, the number of fatalities involving large trucks has dropped precipitously, Speaker. So again, when we take into account all of these factors, road and highway safety is of paramount concern to this government. It's a crucial part of my mandate. We will continue to work with the industry. We will continue to work with all partners to make sure that we are delivering road and highway safety for the people of Ontario, as of course they expect and deserve.
Supplementary.
Thank you, Minister. I appreciate your answer, but as you know, and everybody in this House knows, because we spoke about it, the roads last year in Ontario were unsafe to drive on. You know it, and everybody else knows it. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Minister, there is a pattern here. This government cuts costs, and then it cuts corners. In the past few months, we have learned about the serious flaws with Ontario privatized truck drivers' examination centres. We have known for years that privatized winter road maintenance is a mess. And 7 years after the AG report, we are again seeing serious flaws with the commercial vehicle inspection system. When will this government stop cutting corners and endangering Ontarians by restoring proper oversight on the safety of our highways? Our kids and our grandkids deserve no better.
Thank you.
I think the member opposite, Speaker, meant no less. I'm happy to help him with his questions in the future, I suppose. But to be really clear about this, Speaker, you know, I know it might not fit with the opposition's narrative around these issues, Speaker, but I mean the results are clear, and I couldn't be any more clear about this. 13 years in a row, Speaker, the roads and highways in this province have ranked first or second in North America in terms of road and highway safety, Speaker. So, I mean, I said that earlier. I'll continue to say that, Speaker. We have to remember as well, between 2002 and 2011, Speaker, I said this earlier, we have seen the number of fatalities involving large trucks decline by 41%. Speaker, each and every single year, the Ministry of Transportation Enforcement Officers conduct more than 110,000 commercial inspections annually, Speaker. It is this, working together, Speaker, for all of these reasons, we continue to deliver road and highway safety in this province that the people deserve. Thanks for
Thank you. New question, the member from Newmarket Aurora.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Natural Resources and Forestry. The forestry sector is an important industry for our province, Mr. Speaker, employing nearly 170,000 people and generating more than $11 billion for Ontario's economy. Trade with the United States is significant to this sector, generating exports valued at close to $5 billion and accounting for as much as 95% of Ontario's forestry and wood product manufacturing exports. Recently, the nearly decade-long softwood lumber agreement between the U.S. and Canada expired. Discussions about this agreement and any future softwood lumber trade agreements between the governments of Canada and the United States will have significant effect on Ontario's forestry sector. Speaker, can the minister tell us about the current status of the softwood lumber agreement?
Question taken. Minister of Natural Resources and Forestry.
Speaker, thank you very much. I want to thank the member from Newmarket Aurora for this question. The softwood lumber agreement, Speaker, is obviously very important to us here in our ministry and to the forest products sector in Ontario. The agreement first penned in 2006, Speaker, expired in 2013. There have been two subsequent one-year extensions of that agreement. It's fully expired as of October of this year. We now find ourselves, Speaker, in a situation contained in the original 2006 agreement that is referred to as a standstill period. What that means, Speaker, is there is about 1 year of what would be considered to be free trade between Ontario as a forest products exporter and the United States, where they have agreed in the 2006 agreement not to import any duties or taxes on the exporting industry in Ontario. This is a period of time where we need to be vigilant and be working towards the new agreement. We are reaching out to our federal partners, who are obviously the lead on the file, Speaker, seeing what we can do to prepare ourselves for the end of the standstill.
Yeah. Supplementary.
Well, thank you, Minister, for the update on the current status of the process. It's important that this is a priority for you and the Ministry of Natural Resources, and I'm satisfied that it is. It's also clear that this agreement is complex and complicated to negotiate.
Right.
At the same time as negotiations move along, issues may develop in a rapid manner. This will require Ontario be prepared to quickly respond to requests for information and proposals. Can the minister tell us how his ministry is working with the industry, other levels of government and other stakeholders to ensure continued access to the important U.S. market for our softwood lumber products?
Minister.
Mr. Speaker, again, I want to thank the member from Newmarket Aurora for the question. Speaker, we have spent a great deal of time in our industry, or in our ministry rather, reaching out to industry on this particular file. There are three major softwood lumber exporters in the province of Ontario, Resolute, AECOM, and Tembec. Of course, there are others in the industry who export into the market. They are the three biggest players, Speaker. Most of their product does go to the U.S. We've also been in contact with Ontario's trade reps in Washington, and as I mentioned in my opening remarks, Speaker, we have been done outreach to our federal counterparts. We're looking to sit down as soon as we can with our new federal ministers who have their hands on this file. As I mentioned earlier, they are the lead, but we will do everything that we can to ensure that Ontario's interests are represented in federally led negotiations with our American partners on this. Speaker, we understand fully the importance of this industry to Ontario, and we understand very clearly the importance of this industry to Northern Ontario specifically, Speaker, and we'll do everything that we can to represent their interests. Thank you.
New question. The member from Thornhill.
To the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care. Mr. Speaker, we are joined in the gallery today by patients and their families suffering from a brain-threatening disease called PKU. Comme le ministre le sait,
as the minister knows, PKU is a hereditary illness that you find in one in every 12,000 newborns in Canada. The new medication has been approved in 2010 and it was classified in 2013.
Single Ontario patient has gained access to Kuvan due to this government's highly restrictive criteria. En fait, les trois seuls qui ont
people who have applied for this treatment were rejected.
Advocates has actually filed a complaint to the College of Physicians and Surgeons because of frustration with this government's mishandling of the file. Mr. Speaker, let me say it again. Not one single patient has received
question.
A treatment that government officials have approved. Est-ce que cela vous semble juste?
Is this fair to you?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I appreciate the question. I think the member opposite knows that we took the politics out of funding drugs in this province, and our decisions on which drugs to fund are based on science and evidence, Mr. Speaker. In the case of Kuvan, in 2011, the National Common Drug Review issued a do not list recommendation for the drug. Twice the province reviewed Kuvan, both reviews resulting in a do not list recommendation. But despite three negative recommendations, Mr. Speaker, Ontario in February of 2013, since that time we have been funding through our exceptional access program Kuvan on a case-by-case basis. The criteria for funding were established with input from the manufacturer and from clinicians who treat PKU. In June of this year, the manufacturer BioMarin informed the ministry that they now intend to file a resubmission to the Common Drug Review. We look forward to seeing that submission and reviewing it for the fourth time, Mr. Speaker.
Two, supplementary.
Again, to the minister, I think the question here is that the criteria is too difficult, and the government knows that 2 years ago, all of Ontario's specialists who treat PKU wrote to the government to express their concerns with the criteria. Ils ont même fourni des
they have given suggested revisions in order to be sure that patients would receive the treatment they really need. But to date, these experts were ignored.
Again, written to you to express their continued frustration at the lack of Kuvan access in Ontario. Monsieur le Président, je vais
Mr. Speaker, a page will give to the minister a medical proof that says that we have to modify those criteria. A proof that the ministry has chosen to ignore.
So these patients can receive the treatment they desperately need. Thank you very much.
Merci. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I do want to acknowledge the advocates and patients who are here today. This is an incredibly challenging and life-threatening illness. But, Mr. Speaker, Saskatchewan is the only other Canadian jurisdiction to list Kuvan with precisely the same criteria as Ontario. BC chose not to list the drug. Quebec funds maternal PKU, which is the case in Ontario as well. This indication is also covered in Ontario, and Quebec considers other requests on a case-by-case basis. Alberta was identified by advocates as funding. We found out that this was through a temporary disability program. Alberta no longer funds PKU. It's not funded in the UK. It's not funded in New Zealand. We need to be consistent, Mr. Speaker, take the politics out of this, make our decisions based on science and good evidence. Notwithstanding that, Mr. Speaker, we have made this drug available on an exceptional access basis to those individuals who truly do need it, where it has been proven to be beneficial.
Thank you. Your question, the member from London West.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Acting Premier. This morning, Londoners learned that 500 surgeries in our local hospitals will be cancelled to be rescheduled at a later date. This means that 500 patients who've already been waiting in pain for up to 2 years will be forced to wait even longer. One of my constituents, Brian Peck, was told in November 2014 that he needed a hip replacement, but it may not be scheduled until the end of 2016. He is using a walker and has already fallen 3 times because of his hip. The surgeon says he will probably be in a wheelchair by the time he gets the surgery. Speaker, the hospitals say they've run out of money. The Lynn blames the hospitals for booking too many surgeries. My question is, who in this Liberal government is looking out for patients, for these 500 people in London who are now facing a health care crisis?
Thank you. Deputy Premier.
To the Minister of Health.
Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. This is obviously an extremely important issue, and we have an expectation that both through our LHINs and hospitals directly, that they continue to work together closely, not only within the fiscal framework provided to them, but in a manner, importantly and critically, Mr. Speaker, that maintains and enhances the quality of care that's provided for those that depend on that resource. So our expectation in this, as all cases, that patient care will not be impacted. I do need to point out, Mr. Speaker, that our funding to the London Health Sciences Centre has risen by 72% over the last decade, an increase of more than $316 million. We have a commitment to make sure that that level of service that the individuals in London and the London area deserve,
answer,
that service is available and provided to them.
Supplementary, the member from London Fanshawe.
Speaker, back to the Acting Premier. Wait times are already longer in London than other parts of the province, and surgeries in our hospitals keep getting cancelled. In March, I stood up in this House and I asked the minister to stop the cuts to elective surgeries that month. The minister refused. Now it's happening again. 500 patients in London will wait even longer for surgery because this Liberal government failed to do its job. Will this Liberal government take responsibility and stop the latest cuts to surgeries, or will the Acting Premier make more excuses and force 500 patients to wait even longer? Which is it?
Thank you. Minister of Health.
Speaker, I do remember distinctly when the member opposite raised this about a year ago, or just under a year ago. In that case, it was her assumption that these were cuts or somehow unpredictable. In fact, they were part of regularly scheduled closures of the OR that occurs in a number of hospitals or is reduced in a number of hospitals over the holiday season, Mr. Speaker. In this case, I will certainly investigate what the particulars of this allegation are, but I do maintain my commitment and responsibility to ensure that the quality of care provided through that hospital, as others throughout the province, is maintained, and I will be following up directly with the hospital as well as the LHIN, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. New question, the member from Sudbury.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Minister of Northern Development and Mines. Mr. Speaker, Ontario has a rich and long mining heritage that has created wealth and helped to build our province into what it is today. But, Mr. Speaker, every now and then in communities across Ontario, there are former mine sites that need to be rehabilitated. Mr. Speaker, I'm proud to be a member of a government that understands that cleaning up these sites helps to protect the environment as well as the health and well-being of all Ontarians. So, Mr. Speaker, would the Minister of Northern Development and Mines share with this House how our government continues to ensure that our environment is protected and abandoned mine sites
Question.
Are cleaned up?
Minister of Northern Development and Mines.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And that's just a great question, very timely question from the member for Sudbury, and certainly, obviously, a great advocate for the mining industry, but a very strong advocate for the environment as well, and much appreciated. And the truth is, our government takes the health and safety of all Ontarians very, very seriously, and that's why we're committed to the Abandoned Mines Rehabilitation Program to ensure that abandoned mines are indeed rehabilitated. And since the beginning of the Abandoned Mines Rehabilitation Program, we've undertaken rehabilitation on 80 of the highest priority abandoned mine sites located throughout the province. And this, Mr. Speaker, this work demonstrates our very strong commitment to a sustainable mining industry that works to ensure protection of the environment and provides substantive and sustainable benefits to our residents our communities. Thank you.
Patrick.
Mr. Speaker, and I'm certainly pleased to hear the minister speak to the important work our government is doing to ensure abandoned mine sites located throughout Ontario are cleaned up to protect our natural environment. The Abandoned Mines Rehabilitation Program is an integral part of Ontario's Mining Act, Mr. Speaker, which is administered by the Ministry of Northern Development and Mines. So, Mr. Speaker, since 2003, the government has invested in this program, and communities across Ontario are seeing the benefits. So, Mr. Speaker, through you to the minister, how is our government protecting the environment while ensuring the mining industry is properly prepared to fulfill their duty to rehabilitate their mining sites?
Thank you, Minister.
Thank you. And again, Mr. Speaker, I'm very grateful because, quite frankly, I don't think there's enough known about this incredibly important program. Since 2003, our government has allocated over $100 million to the Abandoned Mines Rehabilitation Program. It supported the rehabilitation of mine sites in many communities. Certainly, the Kamkosha site outside Timmins is a great example. Bancroft, Sudbury, many other locations as well. We are very committed to the protection of the environment by ensuring that all mining projects also obtain necessary provincial environmental approvals and permits, and that appropriate consultation with the public and, of course, Aboriginal communities that takes place. It's incredibly important, and we are very committed to that. And under the Mining Act, Mr. Speaker, mining companies must submit closure plan, closure and rehabilitation plans for our ministry. Again, something I don't think that is well known the public. This is
important. Yeah, thank you. New question, the member from Nipissing.
Thank you very much, and good morning, Speaker. My question is for the Deputy Premier. Residents in northeastern Ontario didn't need the Auditor General to tell us the Lynn has done a terrible job delivering health care. But thanks to the auditor, she's confirmed what Northerners are feeling. The Northeast Lynn was tied for the worst in the province, meeting just 4 of the 15 targets.
Wow.
They are worst in alternate level of care days, second worst in wait times for CCAC in-home services, and they're one of only 2 Lynns not meeting the target of providing cancer care surgery within 84 days.
Wow.
The ineptness of the Northeast Lynn is nothing new. Just sad to see that it still continues. I asked the Deputy Premier,
Question.
Speaker, what is her plan to improve health care for Northerners?
Thank you. Deputy Premier.
The Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. And I know it's the agenda of the member opposite and his party to get rid of the Lynns and fire the workers that are providing that integrated health care and coordinating health care at the local level. And I know it's the mandate and the aim of the party opposite to dissolve the Lynn boards that are comprised of local community members who, frankly, Mr. Speaker, best know what the unique and specific health care needs of those communities are. So, Mr. Speaker, the Auditor General has pointed to some important recommendations where we need to improve the functioning of the Lynns. We intend to take those recommendations very seriously, Mr. Speaker. We will invest in those recommendations to ensure that the quality of care and the level of integration is what it needs to be, Mr. Speaker. But I'm not going to go down the path that the member opposite wants to go down, Mr. Speaker. We believe in the importance of local decision-making, and we will continue to support that.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Back to the Deputy Premier. Well, Speaker, they're the only party firing 350 health care workers in the city of North Bay. In 2012, the Northeast Lynn met zero of their 15 performance targets. Any other organization would have made management changes immediately. But what did they do at the Northeast Lynn instead? They spent over $750,000 to renovate their offices. The auditor was clear. She said, quote, the ministry does not consistently hold Lynns accountable when they do not meet their targets. Well, no kidding. Deputy, the buck stops with your government. I ask the Speaker, what change does the government plan to make sure that the Northeast Lynn ensures health care dollars are spent on patients, not on leather chairs and fancy drinks?
Question. Thank you.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please.
Thank you. Minister.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I know that the member opposite has an agenda to discredit the Lynns, to eventually result in their dissolution. We don't subscribe to that view. We actually believe of the paramount importance that we give local decision makers through a community board.
Finish, please.
Where we give decision-making responsibilities to a...
Stop the clock. The member from Renfrew-Nipissing-Pembroke, warned. No, we have all kinds of time. It's not just 4 seconds. It could be any time. Finish, please.
To give that responsibility to local decision makers, Mr. Speaker, we've increased the funding to the Northeast Lynn to over $1.4 billion this year. Our funding for CCACs has increased by 50%. Despite what the PCs would like the public to believe, we have a strong record of providing quality health care in the northern part of this province, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. The member from Renfrew-Nipissing-Pembroke on a point of order.
Yes, thank you very much, Speaker. I did speak to the House earlier today, and I said I had some big news, and I wanted to confirm that. I just received some vital statistics on the arrival of our newest grandchild. 10 pounds, 12 ounces, 22 inches long. He's already bigger than Vic Fedeli.
That's actually not a point of order, but it was a good one. We have a deferred vote on the motion for third reading of Bill 122, an act to amend the Mental Health Act and the Health Care Consent Act 1996. Calling the members, this will be a 5-minute bell.
All members, please take your seats. On December 7, 2015, Mr. Hoskins moved third reading of Bill 122, an act to amend the Mental Health Act and the Health Care Consent Act 1996. All those in favor, please rise one at a time and be recognized by the clerk.
Mr. Hoskins.
Mr. Hoskins.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Shirelli.
Mr. Shirelli.
Mr. Shirelli.
Madame Mayer.
Madame Mayer.
Mr. Souza.
Mr. Souza.
Ms. Matthews.
Ms. Matthews.
Ms. Sandals.
Ms. Sandals.
Mr. Duguid.
Mr. Duguid.
Ms. McCharles.
Ms. McCharles.
Mr. Quinter.
Mr. Quinter.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Takkar.
Mr. Takkar.
Mr. Berardinetti.
Mr. Berardinetti.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Zimmer.
Madame Lalonde.
Madame Lalonde.
Mr. Quadri.
Mr. Quadri.
Mr. Balkison.
Mr. Balkison.
Ms. Albanese.
Ms. Albanese.
Mrs. Manga.
Mrs. Manga.
Mr. Kraft.
Mr. Kraft.
Ms. Hunter.
Ms. Hunter.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Morrow.
Mr. Morrow.
Ms. Jassic.
Ms. Jassic.
Mr. Del Duca.
Mr. Del Duca.
Ms. Domerla.
Ms. Domerla.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Wong.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Dong.
Mr. Dong.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Molly.
Ms. Molly.
Mrs. Martin.
Mrs. Martin.
Mrs. McGarry.
Mrs. McGarry.
Ms. McMahon.
Ms. McMahon.
Mr. Milchin.
Mr. Milchin.
Ms. Naidu.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Ms. Verniel.
Ms. Verniel.
Mr. Tebow.
Mr. Tebow.
Mr. Urich.
Mr. Urich.
Mr. Arnott.
Mr. Arnott.
Mr. Hardiman.
Mr. Hardiman.
Ms. McLeod.
Ms. McLeod.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Wilson.
Ms. Jones.
Ms. Jones.
Mr. Brown.
Mr. Brown.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Miller, Perry, Sound, Muskoka.
Mr. Miller, Perry, Sound, Muskoka.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Scott.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mr. McLaren.
Mr. McLaren.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Nichols.
Mr. Nichols.
Ms. Marteau.
Ms. Marteau.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. Pettipiece.
Mr. Pettipiece.
Madame Gélinas.
Madame Gélinas.
Monsieur Bisson.
Monsieur Bisson.
Mr. Vantoff.
Mr. Vantoff.
Mr. Miller, Hamilton, East Stony Creek.
Mr. Miller, Hamilton, East Stony Creek.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Taylor.
Ms. Taylor.
Mr. Nadeshak.
Mr. Nadeshak.
Ms. Armstrong.
Ms. Armstrong.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Forrester.
Ms. Forrester.
Monsieur Montauk.
Mr. Montauk.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mr. Hatfield.
Ms. Gretzky.
Ms. Gretzky.
Mr. Gates.
Mr. Gates.
Ms. French.
Ms. French.
All those opposed, please rise one at a time and be recognized by the clerk.
The nays are zero.
The ayes being 91 and the nays being zero, I declare the motion carried. Be it resolved that the bill do now pass and be entitled as in the motion. We have a deferred vote on the government notice of motion number 60, time allocation of Bill 109. Call on the members. This will be a 5-minute bell. December the 8th, 2015, Mr. Gravel moved to notice a motion number 60. All those in favor of the motion, please rise one at a time. Be recognized by the clerk.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Shirelli.
Mr. Shirelli.
Madame Mayer.
Madame Mayer.
Mr. Souza.
Mr. Souza.
Ms. Matthews.
Ms. Matthews.
Mr. Hoskins.
Mr. Hoskins.
Ms. Sandals.
Ms. Sandals.
Mr. Duguid.
Mr. Duguid.
Ms. McCharles.
Ms. McCharles.
Mr. Quinter.
Mr. Quinter.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Takkar.
Mr. Takkar.
Mr. Berardinetti.
Mr. Berardinetti.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. McMeekin.
Meekin.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Leo.
Mr. Leo.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Zimmer.
Madame Lalonde.
Madame Lalonde.
Mr. Quadri.
Mr. Quadri.
Mr. Balkison.
Mr. Balkison.
Ms. Albanese.
Ms. Albanese.
Ms. Manga.
Ms. Manga.
Mr. Kraft.
Mr. Kraft.
Ms. Hunter.
Ms. Hunter.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Morrow.
Mr. Morrow.
Ms. Jassy.
Ms. Jassy.
Mr. Del Duca.
Mr. Del Duca.
Ms. Domerla.
Ms. Domerla.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Wong.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Dong.
Mr. Dong.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Molly.
Ms. Molly.
Mrs. Martin.
Mrs. Martin.
Mrs. McGarry.
Mrs. McGarry.
Ms. McMahon.
Ms. McMahon.
Mr. Milchin.
Mr. Milchin.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Ms. Verniel.
Ms. Verniel.
Mr. Tebow.
Mr. Tebow.
All those opposed, please rise one at a time. Be recognized by the clerk.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Ryan.
Mr. Arnott.
Mr. Hardiman.
Mr. Hardiman.
Ms. McLeod.
Ms. McLeod.
Ms. Jones.
Ms. Jones.
Mr. Brown.
Mr. Brown.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Miller, Perry Sound, Muskoka.
Mr. Miller, Perry Sound, Muskoka.
Ms. Scott.
Scott.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mr. Urich.
Mr. Urich.
Mr. McLaren.
Mr. McLaren.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Nichols.
Mr. Nichols.
Ms. Marteau.
Ms. Marteau.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. Pettipies.
Mr. Pettipies.
Mr. Bisson.
Mr. Bisson.
Mr. Vantoff.
Mr. Vantoff.
Mr. Miller Hamilton East Stoney Creek.
Mr. Miller Hamilton East Stoney Creek.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Taylor.
Ms. Taylor.
Mr. Natashek.
Mr. Natashek.
Ms. Armstrong.
Ms. Armstrong.
Madame Gelinas.
Madame Gelinas.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Forrester.
Ms. Forrester.
Mr. Montauk.
Mr. Montauk.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mr. Hatfield.
Ms. Gretzky.
Ms. Gretzky.
Mr. Gates.
Mr. Gates.
Ms. French.
Ms. French. The ayes are 54, the nays are 37.
You should have stayed the leadership.
The ayes being 54 and the nays being 37, I declare the motion carried. The Chief Government Whip on a point of order.
On a point of order, listen, I wouldn't have not done my job. I forgot to mention someone else's birthday today. That is class of 2014, our newest colleague, Yvonne Baker. Happy birthday. Bye bye, Yvonne. Happy birthday.
There are no further. The member from Eglinton Lawrence on a point of order.
Since there's people from all over Ontario here, in support of Bill 141, the Pregnancy and Infant Loss Bill, I want to let them know that the bill passed through unanimous consent of all parties. Thank you.
There are no further deferred votes. This House stands recessed until 3 p.m. this afternoon.